Okay, welcome to today's lecture. And I would like to start with a small numerical experiment. So let me start by reminding you how we finished on Monday. And I introduced the Kaczmarz method, more or less that consisted of the following problem. We are looking for a solution of the problem RF equals G, and R is the operator R is broken up into a finite number of sub-operators R0 to RP minus 1, and we are looking for a common solution of the problems. That means we are looking for one F which satisfies RKF equals GK for key from 0 to P minus 1. The standard example for this is, let's think of parallel scanning in CT. Then you probably have something like P positions of the X-ray source. So for each position, you get one data set, you get one operator, and these are the operators RK for a fixed position XK of the X-ray source. We have an operator RK, and we have the measured data GK, and of course, we are looking for a common solution F that solves all RKF equals GK. Now, we could apply Landweber to the whole system, and that would mean we have a very large system, and we'll have to apply very large matrices. And instead, we had the idea in the Kaczmarz method of treating each of these equations individually. So for one iteration step of the Kaczmarz method, we just choose one position of the X-ray source. We choose one K over here, solve the underdetermined system, and take that as our iterator. Okay, so that's more or less the idea, and we already applied that to a semi-discrete version of the of computerized tomography. So it's exactly what I just described. We have a finite number of positions of the X-ray source where data is measured, but we assume that the data is measured continuously for each of these positions. And we already derived what that means, what has to be done in each Kaczmarz step. More or less, that amounts to just doing the back projection of the measured data multiplied with this function over here, so multiplied with this weight. So in each step of the algorithm, we'll have to apply the Radon transform once, so but only for one single angle, and then we'll have to do the back projection, but also again for just one single angle. So we have in each single step, we're using just one data set of the P data set that we measured, and of course the amount of the cost of what we have to do is very low. And we already noticed that the time that we use for doing one Landweber step is the same as doing one sweep, so computing P iterations of the Kaczmarz method. Okay, I implemented exactly this over here in a discretized version, of course. So I took the semi-discrete version and then discretized that again. So that's what I did, and that's what you'll see now. Let me just point out one more thing, because I think I didn't go back to Landweber last time. So let's just have a very short look at the definition of Landweber again. So this is the Landweber method. And let us assume that we are starting with a zero guess. So let's take F0 or U0 in this case equal to zero. And then we have more or less U1 is K star G. So the first iterate that you get is just the adjoint applied to the measured data, and that's exactly what we called unfiltered back projection. So the first step that we would get using Landweber would be unfiltered back projection, and we know that this is not a very good approximation. It's so that is probably not an excellent method in this case, and we'll see that. Okay, now I lost my mouse. There it is. Okay. So I programmed this in our programming system, and as usual, I will give you the program so you can try it out and do some more to get a better feeling for this, right? And I really recommend doing that. Okay, I'm using all the stuff for the radon transform, which I already defined, and I also use the back projection that I already defined, so this is going to be rather short. There's almost nothing that has to be done here. Okay, we take the modified Shep-Logan image as an example, as a phantom. We generate the data with the optimal ratio of P and Q. We chose Q as 64, and then P is given by Q times pi. That's the optimal rate, the optimal scanning rate, the optimal sampling rate that we derived. And we simulate the measurements, and that's the parallel projection of our phantom. And I'm just reusing everything which I already defined. Okay, now there was that weight. You remember that? There was that 1 over square root 1 minus s squared that I need to use for the back projection in the Kaczmarz step. And I put this in here. So this one just implements the weight that is in the Kaczmarz step. Okay, let's look at what Landweber would give us after one step. And remember, that's the same as the same effort as you computing the pth step of the Kaczmarz method. Well, that's just unfiltered back projection, and that's what comes out. So after quite some effort, this is what we would get by using Landweber, and this will be our reference. And of course, we want to do better than that. Okay, now what has to be done in a single art step? Well, we are just using the projection data num. And of course, we need a current guess. So we're using the data. We're using data set number num. So this is now in single. There is a projection angle that belongs to that. And what we need to do is just back project that. First, we need to forward project to get the G minus RF. So this is the forward projection that we use. And then we do the back projection, and you see that this is multiplied with fux, so that's the thing that is the weight that I already computed. So we have for each single step of the Kaczmarz method, we have one forward projection, that's this one, we have one back projection, that's this one, and so that's the effort we have to use. Okay, then we defined a sweep as using all the data once. So the art sweep is exactly what I have here. So we do P single steps. And after doing these steps, we've used all the data once. And so that's the same effort as with Landweber. Okay, so let's look at what a single step, single iteration in Kaczmarz is doing. We're starting with an initial guess of 0. We're taking data set number 25, doesn't matter. We select omega equal to 1. I will comment on that later. And we will perform one single art step. So let's thing, what would we expect? We would expect that it does a back projection along one single data set. So this is a back projection along one single angle. And let me show you that this is actually the case. Ah, I will have to run it. Okay. So let me run this. Okay. Yeah, that's exactly what we would expect, right? I mean, we measured along this angle over here, back projection. Back projects everything along that direction. So it's constant along along lines in this direction, and that's what comes out of it. Okay, and if you remember, we selected this iterate in such a way that the equation number num, which was I think 25, is now satisfied. So if I compare the forward projection of this one for angle number 25 with the data that was measured for 25, then that should be the same. And in fact, that is the case, right? I mean, I did the back projection in such a way that the equation number 25 is satisfied, and this is the forward projection. I think the orange one is the forward projection, the blue one is the measurement, and you see that they coincide, and that's exactly what we would assume, right? I mean, that was Kaczmar's idea. We take the next iterate such that one single data set is now, one single equation is satisfied, and this is exactly what we see here. Okay, now just for fun, what happens if we apply Kaczmarz twice with omega equals to 1 for the same equation? Well, it shouldn't do anything because the equation is already satisfied, so it should not change the current iterate, and that's what in fact happens. I've applied ART twice here for data set number 25. So I've applied the back projection twice for data set number 25. And you see there's almost no change over here, right? So this is almost the same. There's some edge effects over here, right? But generally it's exactly the same as before. So this is true. If I apply the same data set twice, then nothing happens. So that's something we shouldn't do. Okay, now let me look at what does the real first iterate of the Kaczmarz method look like. So what comes out if I use all the data once, and I again take omega equal to 1. And yeah, that's what we get out, and that looks very good, right? I mean, compare that to the iteration, to the quality that we received after doing one Landweber step, then this is way ahead, right? Okay, this was one sweep, so I've used all the data once at this point. What you can see is, well, there's some strange artifacts over here, and there's also some shadows over here. And maybe we'll get over that by working a little bit more. So take three iterations of the Kaczmarz method here. So let's try this. So we're doing three sweeps, and they even get worse. And the problem is that I'm completely ignoring error here. So G has no error. And selecting omega high will enhance that error. So it's not a good idea to use a high value of omega unless you do early stopping. So we should definitely choose omega smaller. So let's take it something like 0.2. I think 0.2 was okay. Yeah, and that looks much better now, very much better now. Okay, but I think now if I choose omega small n, then you see this is not very good, right? I mean, this is the approximation that I get after one for one iterate is not very good if omega is chosen small. Okay, so that looks all very nice. Probably the iteration speed is not too large, but at least it works, and we know that we somehow get the idea that we'll have to choose omega right. Now there's one thing I would like to point at, and let me go back to just doing one iteration of the Kaczmarek step. So let me just apply for phi equals to zero, so only one data set, and let's do the back projection. Okay. That's not what it was supposed to look like. I see. I fixed the limits over here. I will just release this for a second. Okay, and then you see how the first adjoint, how the first iterate of the Kaczmarek step looks like. Okay, that's what's come out. That's the back projection along one single direction, as we already saw. Okay, so now let's do this twice. So let's use two data sets. Let's use data set 0 and data set 1, and let's look at how that looks like. Well, the thing is, probably you don't see any difference, right? How can that be? Well, remember what the Kaczmarek method actually does. It first takes the operator along angle 0, then it takes the operator along angle 1. These are almost the same. So that means that also the operators are almost the same, and also the data will be almost the same. So we cannot expect that there's a lot of difference between the two iterates that we have, because we don't bring in very much more information, right? And in a way, one would feel, well, it's not a good idea to use the just adjacent angle. Probably we should use some information that's completely orthogonal. So maybe we should just use the orthogonal angle. And let's do that again. So now I use angle direction 0 and angle direction pi over 2. And yes, that looks very much better. Right? I mean, it's not perfect. But remember, we only have two directions, and already we have a faint idea of where the object actually is, and it doesn't look too bad. Okay, maybe we can improve that by adding some more angles. And again, we now choose them as orthogonal as possible, as I think pi over 4 and 3 pi over 4. And that actually looks quite good, right? I mean, it's not, compare it to what we had, almost nothing. So it seems to be a good idea not to choose the directions in consecutively, but to use them in a most orthogonal way in a way that's as orthogonal as possible. Okay, so the order of the measurements is important. And when people realized that, they immediately came up with very clever schemes that would choose the angles as orthogonal as possible and would thus guarantee a high convergence speed. However, it quickly turned out that the real problem is if you use it consecutively, then that's a bad idea. If you don't do it, it's almost the same whatever you use. So just taking a random order is okay. And that's what we're going to do now. So I'm first going to copy the one, and then I'm just permuting the measurements and the direction. So I'm permuting the operators and the data now. That's what I did. And now let's take, for example, 10. We had 0.2. And let's take, for example, 10 iterates. So we use 10 of the more than 200 data sets we have measured. And let's see what comes out of that. And that's not too bad. I mean, remember, we had over 200 data sets measured. That was what we used for the reconstruction up there. And this is only 10. And we already have a very rough idea of what the image looks like. If I would do the same thing just for the ordered data sets, then I wouldn't see anything. Okay, that's good. So let's now take one sweep. And yeah, as you would assume, after you get a very good iterate by using one sweep here. And yeah, I mean, that's almost perfect, right? So you can enhance convergence speed by rotating, permuting the operators. And so the order of operators really makes a difference. And this, in fact, when people started using that method, it was very, very slow, up to a point where it was just unusable. And after this had been discovered, that you can just simply accelerate the method by permuting the operators, it's now also a standard method. And as I said, it's actually used in non-standard computerized tomographs.